great vessels, aorta, and branches of the aorta. In this video, we'll talk about the great vessels of the heart. We'll also discuss the major distribution networks of the aorta by region. We'll outline the regions served by the common internal and external carotid arteries. And we'll discuss the major arterial branches of the thoracic part of the descending aorta. So the great vessels of the heart refer to any vein or artery that is connecting to the heart. Veins conduct blood back to the heart. Arteries conduct blood away from the heart. So in this particular photograph, we can see the superior portion of the heart contained within the pericardium. Here are the lungs that are lateral to the heart. Here is the ascending aorta going into the arch of the aorta. Here, going into the descending aorta. And here are some of the branches of the arch of the aorta. What we can also see is that the venous supply of the anterior thoracic here has been cut. Let me erase this to show you what I mean. So here and here are stumps from the left brachiocephalic vein. This vein would have crossed the superior mediastinum like so, covering over these branches of the arch of the aorta. So the two brachiocephalic veins come together to feed into the superior vena cava. In terms of systemic circulation, the major venous systemic route is the caval system. The caval system consists of all blood that flows into the superior and the inferior vena cavae. The superior vena cava drains everything superior to the diaphragm, the thorax, the upper limbs, the head and neck. The inferior vena cava drains everything inferior to the diaphragm, the abdominal pelvic cavity, and the lower limbs. Both of these veins converge in the right atrium. So systemic venous blood returns to the heart at the right atrium. From the right atrium, blood is conducted through the tricuspid valve into the right ventricle. The right ventricle sends blood out through the pulmonary semilunar valve into the pulmonary trunk, keeping in mind this is deoxygenated blood. That pulmonary trunk divides into right and left main pulmonary arteries. And those pulmonary arteries conduct blood to the capillary beds of the alveoli of the lungs, where that blood picks up oxygen and dumps carbon dioxide. Oxygen is necessary for chemiosmosis so that we can generate ATP. Carbon dioxide is a byproduct of cellular metabolism. That richly oxygenated blood returns back to the heart through pulmonary veins. Now, mind you, these pulmonary veins are conducting some of the most oxygenated blood in the body. So we need to divorce ourselves from the concept that veins carry deoxygenated blood and arteries carry oxygenated blood. That may hold true for the systemic loop, but it falls apart for the pulmonary loop. That richly oxygenated blood from the pulmonary veins is delivered to the left atrium. The left atrium sends blood through an atrioventricular valve called the bicuspid or mitral valve into the left ventricle. The left ventricle then sends blood through the semilunar aortic valve into the ascending aorta. That ascending aorta then goes into the arch of the aorta. The arch of the aorta then feeds into the descending aorta, which has both thoracic and abdominal parts, as we'll see. Now, in this particular image here, we can see the superior vena cava. We can see at least part of the ascending aorta. We can see the arch of the aorta and the beginning of the thoracic part of the descending aorta. Coming off of this arch of the aorta, we have typically three major vessels. There's the brachiocephalic trunk, the left common carotid artery, and the left subclavian artery. The brachiocephalic trunk bifurcates into the right common carotid artery and the right subclavian artery. So as you see, we have two common carotid arteries and two subclavian arteries, and we'll discuss their major branches momentarily. So let's start at the very beginning of this story with the ascending aorta. The ascending aorta is conducting the blood from the left ventricle. There is a valve there called the semilunar aortic valve. And just above the cusps of those valves are two sinuses. They're the coronary sinuses, oftentimes referred to as the sinuses of Valsalva. Now, it's here that we have the origins of the coronary arteries. The coronary arteries are the arteries that supply the heart with blood. And there are two. There is a left coronary artery that we'll call the LCA, and a right coronary artery that we'll call the RCA. And over here on this image, we can see there's the ascending aorta. Here is the LCA, and there is the RCA. And you can see that these arteries have branches that take themselves over the surface of the heart to supply the various muscular walls of the heart with blood. And we'll discuss those branches in detail when we discuss the heart. Now, as you recall, that arch of the aorta has a brachiocephalic trunk, a left common carotid, and then a left subclavian artery. So the subclavian arteries can originate either from the brachiocephalic trunk, if you are the right subclavian artery, or the arch of the aorta, if you're the left subclavian artery. The subclavian artery has three parts to it. These are all relative to this muscle here, which is the anterior scalene muscle. And this is the root of the neck, so it's the transition between the neck and the thorax and the upper limbs. So the first part of the subclavian artery is from there to there. So everything that is medial to the medial edge of anterior scalene is going to have three major branches. One, two, three, that we'll discuss in detail when we discuss the upper limb. The second part of the subclavian artery, which is deep to this anterior scalene muscle, has one branch. And then the third part of the subclavian artery, which is everything lateral to the lateral edge of anterior scalene, out to the lateral margin of rib 1, also has one branch. So 3, 1, and typically 1. Branches. The subclavian artery is going to serve the brain and the interior of the cranial cavity. It's going to serve the neck. It's going to serve the thoracic wall and even the abdominal wall. It's going to serve muscles of the neck and of the shoulder. And the continuity of the subclavian artery is known as the axillary artery, which is traversing the axilla, which is then destined for the remainder of the upper limb. There are also, as you recall, common carotid arteries. And these arteries on the right side originate at the brachiocephalic trunk, and on the left side originate on the arch of the aorta. These common carotid arteries ascend the neck in the carotid sheath, bound to the internal jugular vein, and also snuggled up with the vagus nerve, which you can't see very well. It's behind this limb of ansa cervicalis there. So that is vagus, or cranial nerve 10. These common carotid arteries bifurcate into internal and external carotid arteries that I'll cover in detail in a subsequent video. But suffice it to say, the internal carotid artery has no branches in the neck. It ascends into the cranial cavity where it supplies the brain with blood, as well as helping to supply the spine with blood. It's also going to supply the orbit with blood, and there will be branches that will come out of the orbit to supply the brow or the forehead with blood. Whereas the external carotid artery, heading that way, supplies the neck with blood, it supplies the face with blood, it supplies the scalp with blood, and it has very many branches in the neck. So moving beyond the arch of the aorta, we have the descending aorta. So we can kind of see there's the arch of the aorta coming around, you know, and here is the thoracic aorta. And it's descending down the thorax, just snuggled up adjacent to the esophagus that's right there. The thoracic part of the descending aorta, or just the thoracic aorta, has both visceral and parietal branches. The visceral branches are serving viscera. The parietal branches are serving the body wall. Now, in this cartoonish transverse section, we can get a sense for the directionality of these branches. So this way is anterior. That way would be posterior. We can see that visceral branches tend to be more anteriorly oriented, perhaps not perfectly anteriorly oriented, whereas parietal branches are more posterolateral in their orientation. So I think that the parietal branches are going to be the easiest to understand, as these are intercostal arteries. So they're coming out with segmental regularity underneath the ribs. So they are intercostal, costa ribs. And coming off of this thoracic part are intercostal arteries 3 through 11. The first and second intercostal spaces are served by branches from the second part of the subclavian artery. So they're coming down from high. Whereas 3 through 11 are direct branches coming off of the thoracic aorta. Below the 12th rib, we have the subcostal arteries, which are going out to supply the lateral aspect of the thoracic and abdominal walls. The abdominal aorta is going through, or I guess I should say it's partly surrounded by the vertebral column and the diaphragm, at the aortic hiatus, which is about the T12, or the 12th thoracic vertebral level. The diaphragm is a dome, and so it is going through the lowest level of that dome. Some of the visceral branches include branches to the bronchial tree, and portions of the parenchyma of the lungs called the bronchial arteries. Typically, there are two left and one right bronchial artery. The two left come directly off of the thoracic part, whereas the one right bronchial artery typically comes off of a left bronchial artery. There can be several pericardial arteries, which serve the pericardium. As you can see, someone has named these exquisitely well. There are also, variably, esophageal arteries to supply the esophagus with blood. And then, finally, these can be quite variable, and they could be included in the parietal branches, superior phrenic arteries, which supply the diaphragm with blood. Once the aorta is on the other side of the diaphragm, that descending aorta is known as the abdominal part of the descending aorta, or just the abdominal aorta. And we'll also learn in subsequent videos that there are inferior phrenic arteries from that abdominal part. And that leads us to the assessment question, which is, the brachiocephalic trunk predominantly serves which areas of the body with blood? Head, neck, and upper limbs? That's sounding pretty decent. Left head and neck? No. Let's see. Brachiocephalic trunk supplies the right subclavian artery and the right common carotid artery. So anything with left in it is out. So left out, left out. Right head and neck? That's sounding pretty good. I mean, that's true. It does do that. Right head and neck, upper limb, and portions of thoracic wall. Yeah, there we go. And we know this because the first part of the subclavian artery is going to have the internal thoracic artery supplying the thoracic and even portions of the abdominal wall as well. Thank you very much for your time.